Hello everyone, HPI Guys Model Workshop here, going to take a look at the Lindbergh 64 Dodge 330. And the reason I picked this kit up is so many kits out there are of dream vehicles. The best one on the road, the highest performance model available, the super fancy chrome, takes 25 pounds off your wife edition. And I like when car companies will allow you to build a bone stock version, even a plain Jane version of a car that you would have actually seen on the road, probably parked at the neighbor's house or that your high school teacher drove, and not the full bored out 426 race Hemi, you know, car that you'd see maybe once or twice at most in your entire lifetime. So I picked this kit up. I did get it from my favorite online retailer for about $13, and that's not a bad price at all. I did pick this up quite a while ago, well over a year ago, but it's still available for that price. They're still making it, so there's, you know, no rush to go out and get it if you don't want it. One of the cool features about the kit is that you have all the parts to build either the Slant 6 or the 383. And Lindbergh includes the parts in the box, and we'll go over those in a moment. So you can see they do have some options for you to build it. You can either build it as the 383 sleeper version, which is going to look sweet with just the plain wheels and the hubs, or the Slant 6, which would look pretty much the same that your grandma would have bought and cruised around town in, and that Slant 6 would have lasted for the next 50 years because those things just don't break. So let's take a look at everything that's in the box and see what you think about the kit. Now, this is your standard Lindbergh manual, and you can see the J. Lloyd logo on there as well. And that's just your single sheet fold out manual, nothing real special. You can see up here they give you the directions to build both engines, and then you can decide where to take it from there when you want to install it. And you've got your basic chassis pan construction. You just follow the numbers, go through, and when you're all done, no matter which engine you decided to use, you have a spare engine sitting around. You can either use that in another kit, you know, throw the 383 in a Roadrunner kit, or you can use it in, you know, a Charger or anything like that you want, or in a rod, you could put that for a hot rod. So for the price, you do get the extra kit, or you can use the Slant 6 as well. You could put the Slant 6 into a rod or put it into another car that you wanted to make more of a daily cruiser style. This is one of the only Slant 6s available on the market as far as I know. I think the only other option for the modeler is to buy a resin kit of just the engine, and that I think also has available the speed pack parts that Mopar had at the time for the Slant 6, which made it a pretty potent little street performer. But those resin kits are anywhere from $20 to $30 just for the motor, and you don't get an entire car kit plus an extra engine. It's got a very, very small decal set, you could see there. Very small details, not a whole lot. Couple brand call-outs there. Other finer details. Nothing real special on there. Two license plates for you. Put those to the side. They include some nice tires. They're not all stuck onto a parts tree. They're not plastic. They actually have a brand name molded into them as well. You can see those are Goodyear bias plies. Those are exactly the kind of tires you'd see on Granny's car. Just the basic tires. They look real slick. They're going to look great sitting on the vehicle. And you get four of those. They don't include any extra tires. They don't include any drag parts. This kit is available as numerous different drag kits. Maverick, Color Me Gone, all those different vehicles that they did run. You can also buy the options for those. One of the larger parts trees in the box. And it's all molded in white plastic, clear, and one chrome tree. You can see that's your interior pan here. Sharp looking, and surprisingly for a Lindbergh kit, great interior door detail. And I don't mean to knock Lindbergh, but sometimes they have a big problem with their kits. They don't spend enough time building kits that they design, and sometimes the stuff just doesn't fit right, and the kit doesn't look right either. Here's your transmission housing if you decide to go with the six-cylinder, and then your exhaust, and this will work either way, of course. You're just going to use one or you're going to use two. So you can see that right there. Nicely done. Not a lot of flash on those parts, and they have big pins where they're going to mount underneath the chassis. So that isn't so bad at all. Take a look over here. We've got the rear bench seat. We've got firewall detail there. And we've got those cool-looking steelies. And they did a good job on those. Nothing wrong with that whatsoever. They're going to look good with the hubcaps on there. And those wheels, you definitely got to paint them black. I want to do it exactly like the box top, except I might do it in that off gold color that Mopar used to like to use all the time. Here's what really sells the kit to me, and that's an extra part that fell off the tree, but that's your slant six, folks. That's the bad boy right there. You can see real nice detail on this engine, and I've even read an article by the Mopar model master Tim Boyd that said this is the best kit to get a small engine out of for your Mopars. You can see all the wonderful detail on there, but the only thing is that they haven't paid much attention to the molds, and if I can get the detail in there, there is a heavy amount of flash. Not so much on the 6, but when we get to some other stuff, you're going to see that there's just a extra heavy-duty amount of flash on some of it. And the block goes together nicely. It fell off, so I did test fit it. And you can see... Oh, sorry. You hear that snap? Looks real nice. You can see that's going to go together without any big problems. I might even put the 383 in there and leave the 6 out on a display stand that you can make yourself. So let's grab some more white plastic trees and go through those. There's the rest of the white plastic for the kit. And this is where you're going to start to see some issues. You're going to start to go, man, that's a lot of flash on there. You can clean it up, but I would expect that this kit should be bought by an experienced modeler. Don't buy this for your kid, and don't buy this for a first-time modeler, or they're going to get sick of cleaning up all the parts. Or they're going to try to assemble it with the flash on it, and then they're just going to get pissed off. Because with flash in the way, nothing wants to line up right. But other than that, you've got some very respectable detail on there. The radiator looks nice and one-sided, but from the back side it looks nice. You got your suspension is actually separate from your differentials. And the cat's got his own opinion about the amount of flash on this kit that we're going to see. And shocks. Front sway bar. What do we got here? We got the two front seats. Now, I think if you had this with a slant, they would have put a bench seat in it. Not buckets, but I'm not an expert on the 64 Dodge 330. But I would have thought if you would have had a base model, they wouldn't have put bucket seats in there. But I bet you it was an option. Inner fender liners, rear bumper, the nice dashboard, and the dashboard looks pretty vacant there because there's a part that we'll show you in a minute with some pedals, e-brake, and brake, wheel backs, so you can see it's all coming together pretty good. Here's your 383, block halves and transmission, heads, steering wheel, and they're even nice enough to include the battery. So that's pretty cool on there. Last parts tree is Flash City. You can see the fan, the belts, the other additional parts for the motor and suspension. Look at all that flash on there. That's just irritating. You're going to have to clean all that up. Here's your oil pan. You're going to have to, your horns there. You're going to have to clean everything up. Get out the tiny sanding sticks and get to work at it because you're going to have a job ahead of you. Let's take a look at the clear parts tree. That's it right there, and you can see by the deflection that's some pretty thick glass. They didn't take too much time making sure that was super thin and optically perfect, so it is going to look like it's got Coke bottle windows. There's not much you can do about that unless you want to duplicate it in acetate. But you can see, looking at the box through there, you know, that's not the clearest. Maybe you could set an ant on fire with it, though. But it'll work. One of the last parts trees, or the last parts tree, is all the chrome. The chrome is so-so. I wouldn't give it that high of a rating. There is a bunch of defects in it. It's got some, you can see these little, what would you call that on the back there? Pin marks or something like that on there. So that's not so hot, but it would have been a base model car, and unless you want to take all these parts and have them re-chromed, you'll have to deal with it. So there's your grill. A little wash will bring that out real nice. Now let's get to the last set of parts in the kit, and I did put all these together. This is three separate parts as one. I put the hood on, and I snapped the chassis pan inside just to see how it fit, because sometimes Lindbergh kits will be a nightmare, especially their car kits can really be a bear. But as you can see, it actually fits together pretty darn nice, and it does look like a 64 Dodge. It's got that nice square profile to it. And we'll take that hood off. You can see that the hood is nicely done. And see, even the cat agrees. It's got just minor underhood detail, but it's a lot better than being smooth. You can texture that up. And then you can see that the body and the chassis pan go together. And surprisingly, the chassis pan has a darn good amount of detail on it. You know, it really looks like it was stamped out. Front frame, suspension mounts, lots of extra little holes for mounting your exhaust. Make sure it stays where you put it. So overall, my opinion of the Lindbergh 64 Dodge 330 compared to a modern kit, on a scale of 1 to 10, it's a 6, maybe even a 5, because of the flash, because of the lack of perfect detail. If you compare it to kits of its more of its era, you know, when this came out a little while ago, you know, then it's not so bad. It bumps up to about a 7. The main reason you'd want to buy this kit is if you like just a plain Jane looking automobile, and if you want that slant 6. That would be the big reason to buy this kit. And for the price, if you just wanted the slant 6, you can always sell the car kit with the 383 to someone else. So for me, it's definitely worth picking up because of that slant 6 and because I can make it plain Jane. It's not for a beginner. It's not a kid's model. It's an experienced modeler's model. And if you think you can handle the flash and some of the other, you know, minor issues like with the glass and stuff like that, if that's not going to bug you, pick it up. Otherwise, I would say, you know, go ahead and pass on it and look for a more modern kit that'll keep you more satisfied. Thanks for watching.